please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Good evening, you're watching CNBC TV18 and this is After the Bell. Let's see if that sustains though. Thanks, Anuj, for taking us through that. The trade war ceasefire between China and the United States has very clearly prompted and lifted investor mood in the international oil market. Crude has inched up 0.3%. That's Brent crude specifically, as you can see on your screen, at the $78.58 per barrel mark, almost touching that $79 per barrel mark. And it's a similar picture as far as the WTI NYMEX is concerned. The NYMEX is right now at 71.4, up by about 0.2%. However, for India, which imports over 80% of its crude oil requirement, this is bad news. The price of the Indian basket of crude oils has gone upwards of $72 a barrel in May after rising to an average of $69.30 a barrel in April 2018. Now, it had averaged at about $47.56 and $56.43 per barrel respectively during the last two financial years. The impact is very clearly being seen in petrol and diesel prices across the country, which now stand at all-time highs. Now, the rise in the price of petroleum and diesel has given rise to some pertinent questions. For example, with the Indian crude basket currently at around $72 a barrel, why are prices higher than when the Indian basket was at nearly $112 a barrel in 2011 and 2012? Prashant Nair is here to put the numbers into perspective. Prashant, where do prices stand now as compared to from a historic basis?
You know, I've come back to this table and this these numbers and how the numbers break up a couple of times over the last 2 years. So let's do this again, essentially because what we pay at the pump for petrol and diesel are at record highs. And this even as crude oil prices are nowhere near their record highs. I mean, we've touched $80, which is, I mean, a high, a cyclical high, you can call it that, but nowhere near all-time highs. So let's break this down. You look at the thing to focus on is row number 3 and 4. Excise, which is essentially what the government collects, central government collects, is 15 rupees 33 paise a litre. This used to be 3.5 rupees a litre when diesel prices in Delhi were 59 rupees a litre. I mean, this was in October of 2014. Back then, at 59 rupees a litre for diesel in Delhi, oil, international oil prices used to be $100 a barrel. So look at the stark difference. You look at VAT. VAT varies. I mean, excise is steady across the country. VAT varies state by state. 16.75%, it used to be about 7% or so. So, I mean, even as international oil prices are $20 lesser than, I mean, the you know, the point that I've taken, which is October of 2014, what we pay at the pump is at an all-time high. Dealer commission has also gone up, but that, I mean, dealer costs are largely fixed. It doesn't really fluctuate with international oil prices. Let's look at petrol prices and how they are faring in Delhi. I mean, what we pay at the pump is at a record 77 odd rupees a litre. And again, the comparison is the last cyclical peak, which was about 76 rupees 10 paise a litre back in September of 2013. Again, you look at international oil prices, $80, it was $108 a barrel then. Excise, from 10 rupees, it's gone up to 20 rupees. You look at VAT, which is what the state collects, 12.7%. It's more than doubled to 27-odd%, and dealer commission has also gone up as well. So, I mean, you know, and that's the reason why, when you look at what the government is collecting, that has gone up. And that's the reason why the clamor that, well, you know, you raised excise as international oil prices were coming down. You did not pass the benefits on. But now, as international oil prices are rising, why don't you pass it on? Can the government do it? I mean, if you ask economists across the board, the clear resounding answer is no. There is no fiscal headroom available. But even leave that aside, leave the macros aside. You look at the micros for oil marketing companies themselves to be able to make marketing margins what they were making pre-Karnataka, I mean, elections when price hikes were stopped. You know, we need a price increase of between 4 and 5 rupees. Not a I mean, we need an increase of 4 or 5 rupees. We are talking about a cut of whatever, 2 rupees, whatever is being talked about, what the government can do. The last cut which the government effected was 2 rupees late in 2017. So I think, I mean, for all practical purposes, this is a pretty tough decision. And that's the reason why we're saying, I mean, it's between a rock and a hard place.
And that's not a good place to be in. Thanks, though, Prashant, for putting that into perspective. But let's take this story one step further. Prices of petrol and diesel are touching record highs at the back of surging crude prices. The one way to control the spiraling cost of fuel is to reduce excise duty that's levied by the centre. But governments also tell CNBC TV18 that a reduction of even 1 rupee per litre of fuel takes a huge hit on the government's revenue kitty. Sapna Das is here to explain this. Sapna, what are the details you have on the fiscal impact on any possible reduction? How big is the loss?
Well, it's a pretty big loss that we're looking at potentially as of now, though, although in which direction the government will move, it's pretty tough to say. As of now, what we understand is that probably as of now means virtually at this hour, at least, you know, there is no decisive action that it's likely. But this is a huge possibility now, looking at also the fact that there could be an inflationary impact of these rising prices. Having said that, very clearly, a 1 rupee cut in excise, basic excise duty for petrol and diesel could translate anywhere 13,000 crores plus as far as the fiscal hit for the government is concerned. If the quantum of cut is around 2 rupees, and you know, looking at the way the prices are right now, you know, a 2 rupee cut also may appear to be very, very minimal. But you look at it from the government's perspective, that could be a revenue hit of 26,000 crores for the full fiscal. Of course, if they do it in the month of May, then you know, to that extent, you exclude the month of April and the revenue numbers will, you know, get balanced out somewhat in terms of the hit. But this is what the maths looks like. So the question now is that, you know, when is the excise cut coming? More important would be what would be the quantum, because this is right at the beginning of the financial year. If you give away so much of money right in the beginning of the financial year, and if the oil prices continue the way they are, what is the headroom available later on down the road? But the problem is that if you don't do these cuts right now, what happens to the other side of the story, which is the retail inflationary impact and basically burdening the consumers? So it's a tough call to be taken by the government, but the fiscal math is pretty much clear. The other aspect that we also need to keep in mind is that, you know, some tinkering had happened in the road cess at the time of the budget. That had been increased and commensurately the basic excise duty had been reduced. So it's very likely that if any cut has to be passed on, any change in the duty rates have to happen, it will happen in the basic excise duty, because that is also shareable with the states. A road cess or any cess for that matter is something that the centre does not share with the states. So just a small point to be kept in mind.
Okay, Sapna, thanks for taking us through that detailed analysis. Now, as fuel prices surge, Petroleum Minister Dharmendra Pradhan has assured consumers of some relief coming in soon. Talking to media in Bhubaneswar today, the minister said, and I quote now, "The centre is sensitive towards the rising fuel prices. Various alternatives are being explored. I hope something will work out soon," end quote. Moving on from fuel prices, let's talk about the banking sector. PSU bank stocks were buzzing in trade today. As a result, that index ended the day firmly in the green, with almost all major PSU banks closing with strong gains. Now, the relief followed news that Tata Steel has successfully acquired Bhushan Steel under the debt resolution process, a move that will instill optimism among bankers struggling with non-performing assets on their books. State Bank of India was up over 2%, while Bank of Baroda ended the day with a gain of about 3%, and as you can see, PNB saw a surge of almost 5%. Now, earlier today, Financial Services Secretary Rajiv Kumar took to Twitter to share the details of how Tata Steel's takeover of Bhushan Steel had helped reduce non-performing assets of public sector banks. He tweeted, and I quote now, "RBC is transforming credit culture in New India. About 35,000 crore rupees of reduction of NPAs of PSBs in Bhushan Steel case. Reduction of NPAs in individual PSBs range from about 500 crore rupees to even 10,000 crore rupees, end of quote. He went on to add, and I'm quoting again, "Under IBC in Bhushan Steel, PSB's income of about 7,500 crore rupees from write back, future upside through over 6 crore equity shares acquired by PSBs. Decisive shift towards clean credit culture," end of quote. And staying with this very resolution case, the National Company Law Tribunal has refused to stay Tata Steel's takeover of the debt-laden firm, hearing a petition filed by Bhushan Steel's promoter, Neeraj Singhal, who owns roughly about 20% stake in the company, challenging the sale. The tribunal issued notices to Tata Steel, the resolution professional, and the Committee of Creditors. However, the tribunal said that it did not want to stall the resolution process, adding that the process would be subject to the final outcome of the case. Talking to Sapna Das earlier today, Tata Steel's MD and CEO TV Narendra welcomed the NCLAT order. He also shared the details of how Tata Steel is going about this acquisition. Here's an excerpt.
"The judges refused to stay, and we respect that. We're happy with that. Obviously, we would like to move on. We've already spent a lot of time and money in this. We've already paid the bankers. We moved into the assets, so we would like to move on. But I think there is a hearing on the 30th. We'll wait for that. But we'll follow due process as we've done so far."
So now, what is the road ahead? I mean, in terms of the fact that the hearings will continue, how does it, where does it place you in terms of the management control?
Well, as far as we are concerned, we paid the banks and they've transferred the shares in our name. So
36,500 odd crores?
Yeah, absolutely.
Numbers again.
35,200 crores. So we've paid the banks and the banks have transferred the shares in our name. So as far as we are concerned, we are now the owners of Bhushan Steel. And our teams have already moved into the multiple sites. And we are working with the local teams there. And I think the local teams have welcomed us. We are happy to be there. We are happy to work with them. And it's a good company which can do even better.
The latest from the recovery efforts in the Vijay Mallya case, sources exclusively tell CNBC TV18 that the Enforcement Directorate has begun the process of selling the liquor baron's movable and immovable assets. This in a bid to recover over 10,000 crore rupees. Utkarsh Chaturvedi is here to break this up for us. Utkarsh, what comes under the hammer now?
The Enforcement Directorate is all set to move court when it comes to selling the assets of Vijay Mallya. Our sources in Enforcement Directorate tell us that ED was waiting for some clarifications in the new Fugitive Offenders Bill and now is ready and has in fact started the paperwork when it comes to moving court. It will be by the end of this month that ED will move court in respect to selling these assets. ED is looking to garner somewhere around 10,000 crore rupees in this process. Now the stake of Vijay Mallya in United Breweries is also something which ED is looking at selling. Now, ED believes that there is somewhere around 15.2% stake of Vijay Mallya, either held by him or by other private companies, which can be sold and which is unpledged. The valuation of this goes to somewhere around 4,500 crores. Apart from that, there is immovable assets of 6,000 crore rupees, which ED is eyeing at selling. Now remember that this will be the first time after the fugitive offender bills come into place that ED will be moving court against one of these fugitive offenders. So it will be very important as this will set a precedent in courts when it comes to other fugitive offenders including Neera Modi and Mehul Choksi.
Oh, absolutely. But I mean, again, we have to wait till that order is filed in the PMLA court. But thanks, Utkarsh, for taking us through that. Now, in order to tackle the black money menace, the center is taking stringent steps against shell companies. Government officials tell CNBC TV18 that the Ministry of Corporate Affairs may move the amendments in Companies Act during monsoon session to define shell companies in the Companies Act. Now, various government agencies such as the ED and market regulator SEBI are likely to submit their suggestions to the MCA on the exact definition of what shell companies means. At the same time, the ministry is also going through global references for the same. Further, in order to ensure that genuine companies are not designated as shell companies, a standard operating procedure or an SOP will be set up. This proposed SOP for identifying shell companies includes companies with dormant accounts, companies who have not filed annual returns, don't have a physical address, and NPO business turnover. Now, the proposed definitions are to be submitted to Interim Finance Minister Piyush Goyal, and the final call then will be taken by the Prime Minister's office directly. But speaking about the Prime Minister, the United States and China have agreed to put their trade tussle on hold after spending months threatening each other of imposing fresh duties. Both the countries have now agreed to drop those tariff threats. According to United States Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin, US and China have decided to work on a wider trade agreement to address future trade imbalances. Now, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has arrived in Sochi, Russia for an informal meeting with Russian President Vladimir Putin. The Prime Minister's visit will focus on addressing global issues and ways of further boosting the already closed bilateral ties between India and Russia. In the backdrop of US sanctions against some Russian companies, Prime Minister will convey to President Putin that the defense relationship between the two will not be dictated by a third party. Meanwhile, Kerala's health department has been put on high alert after three people died in Kozhikode due to a deadly virus called Nipah. The virus, which has high fatality rates, spreads mainly through bats, pigs and other animals. The Union Ministry has rushed a team to the state to cope with the outbreak. A single window system has been put into place to monitor emergency treatment to meet any eventuality. The health department has even issued directions to all direct medical officers to forward information in case of people with similar symptoms approaching them for treatment to prevent the spread of this disease. From election promise to flagship campaign, the Smart City project has been the cornerstone of the Modi government's vision for India. So as the government completes 4 years in power, CNBC TV18's Kevin Day takes a look at just how much progress has been made on this ambitious project.
plan to convert 100 Indian cities into smart cities was a major item on the BJP's election manifesto in the run-up to the 2014 Lok Sabha elections. However, it was only in January 2016 that India was introduced to the first 20 cities that would be the flag bearers of this project. Since then, 79 more cities have been added to the list, meaning India will one day have 99 smart cities. These 99 cities will receive 500 crore rupees of funding from the central government through the life cycles of their smart city projects and another 500 crore rupees from the governments of the states that they belong to. So one way to track progress is through the amount of funds that have been disbursed. In March this year, a parliamentary standing committee report estimated that less than 2% of the 10,000 crore rupees allocated to the smart cities project had been spent. Housing and Urban Affairs Minister Hardeep Singh Puri was quick to clarify that these numbers were not up to date. According to the minister, 936 projects worth 30,000 crore rupees have either been completed or initiated, while another 400 projects worth 20,000 crore rupees are in the tendering stage. The minister is also optimistic that by the end of 2018, significant progress will be evident.
The expenditure when I joined the ministry was 8,000 crores at that stage on the projects. Today it is already 400% higher. It is 30,000 crores. By June it will be 40,000 crores, and by December 80,000 crores. That is the reason I used to always say you will see the visible manifestations between June and December.
This visual manifestation has already started in some cities. Pune, for example, has a command and control center set up, and about one third of the individual projects have been completed. Similarly, Bhopal has been able to successfully implement pilot projects, including setting up cycle stands for green transport and integrating garbage collection with an Internet of Things interface. However, one third of these future smart cities are yet to even appoint a consultant to guide various projects, and the center has made it clear that it will not babysit municipal corporations.
If the urban local bodies do their job properly, they can raise the finances. It's when you don't do your job properly that you come to the center.
The first round of smart cities are expected to be fully ready by 2021, while the last round of cities have until 2023 to finish executing all the projects in their proposals. So progress is likely to be staggered according to the order in which these cities were awarded smart city status. But for the government, these timelines may be too staggered, especially if it wants to have something concrete to show when the BJP and its allies hit the campaign trail in 2019. In Mumbai, Kevin Lee.